Shortage of light? No. But who is the one that sustains the life, both your life and that life of the other person? Jehovah. What do we do in evangelism? Some people, you know, we are permitted to do signs and wonders, but we can't give divine help. We can pray for somebody to be healed, but we can't assure the person divine health, even in the time of Jesus. When Jesus healed the man that was at the pool of Bethesda, when he saw him again, Jesus told him and said, if you go back to your sin, the same thing will come back to you. If you go back, now that you are cleansed, it's no more in my hand. It's now in the hand of my Father to sustain it. Am I making sense? I'm going to give you scriptures. But what I just want us to understand that God is speaking to us this year. Go deeper. CGMi Australia, go deeper. Go deeper. Go beyond evangelism. Go beyond, because evangelism cannot make anybody born again. Another problem we have is that we think, we don't understand what is born again. We think that when we are saved, we are born again. It's a lie. The proof that we have been delivered means we are born again. But the proof that we have saved, we are saved when we hear the gospel of faith and accept it, we are saved. But everything about you is 100% on earth. You have not been delivered. The seven sons of Sceva, they were saved, but they were not delivered. And when they went to devil, the devil said, the people that I know that are born again, that have died in this world, that they no more live, that I cannot touch again because they are seated in heavenly places with Christ. Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. But why? You only saved that you're coming to suffer. Because you are saved, I can still do anything to you. Hey, and when the devil kick such people at the bumper, boom, they rob the pastor, pray for me, pastor, pray for me, pastor. But anyone born again, the devil cannot say, oh, okay, don't touch it. Touch not my anointed. And do my prophet. Evangelism can direct, but evangelism cannot deliver. You know, there are two laws, and this is what Jesus is saying. The law of righteousness by works, and the law of righteousness by faith. The Jews are still holding and hanging onto the law of righteousness by works. Lord, see my righteousness and save me. Lord, this I have done, this I have done. But righteousness by faith saves because of Jesus. Because of what Jesus has done. I'm following suit. I'm continuing from where he stopped. God is saying, if you're still holding on to the righteousness by works, you can never enter the level of grace. You will remain in the level of faith. Have I taught us that? The hierarchy? God the Father, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one. Then the other one. What? Revelation. Let me tell you, divine revelation is as powerful as Jehovah. And the next one is grace. Then you now come down to faith. That is why the Bible says we are saved by grace through faith. Now, what we want to achieve is for us to be certain that if we're only planning this year to only evangelize the people, we will not achieve what Jehovah wants us to achieve. Many will still go to hell. Many will still go to hell. Let's go to Haggai chapter 2, verse 11 to 13. Just three verses. I must still do this topic. Next one. Shakabura. Are you there? Hada. Are you waiting for me? Why?
Two, President.
2:11.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts. Ask now the priest concerning the law.
Now, did you hear that? He said, ask now the priest concerning what? Okay?
Saying, if one bear holy flesh in the spirit.
No, let's get it. What did God tell us to ask the priest about? The law. Can we say because it was the Old Testament that law is not perfect? I want people to. I started with the law. I started explaining about the law. And I knew I made sense about the law. Now, asking a question, God said, there is a law I want you to understand this year. There is a law I'm going to open your eyes to. There is a law that you do not really understand how it works. Can you please go to the priest and ask about this law? Can you read it again, sir?
Thus saith the Lord of hosts. Ask now the priest concerning the law.
Okay, what is the law? Let's listen now. Listen very well.
Saying, if one bear holy flesh in the skirt of his garment, and with his skirt do touch bread, or pottage, or wine, or oil, or any meat, shall it be holy? And the priest answered and said, no.
No. Let's stop here. He said, if one that is holy touches another that is not holy, will the touch make the other one holy? Remember, he said, ask the priest. The priest will explain this law to you. The priest is a law. Now, why is it that people do not understand or feel? No, this is controversial. It's because they don't know it's a law. It's a law that when you obey, Jesus said, when you practice it, you will now see whether it works. I told you when we were in secondary school how we were using the Bible for occultic needs. As I'm telling you, you'll be thinking it's not real. But how we got that law, and this is what the occultic people are doing, they get a negative law, laws in the Bible, and they use it. Laws in the Bible. Nothing. When you do or is obey the law, there is a reward or consequences. He said, ask the priest. He will tell you about this law. This law is true. Now, before I go forth, I want you to keep this in your mindset. No one can prove to another that Jehovah is real. Let's say I'm going for evangelism now. I want to go out with you. Please remove from your mindset that the message I'm going to preach to this guy will reveal Jehovah through me. Okay, good. Let me show you a scripture that has been misinterpreted, which many are putting themselves in the position of the Holy Spirit. As of Apostles chapter 1, verse 8.
For ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria.
Now listen, he said, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, yea, and this is where people are having a problem with that. Let's say as we are all here, Holy Ghost comes upon us, bam. Is that Holy Ghost that came upon us now, every one of us, is he now one? He came upon many people. So, in the eyes of men, Holy Ghost is in you, Holy Ghost is in you, Holy Ghost is in you. He said, together, all of you shall be witnesses in when you go. Technically, who is alive in you now? You are crucified. It's no more you that lives. Who lives in you? Christ. In other words, who is the one that the Bible is talking about? Ye shall be witnesses from what happens to them. If you don't understand, we can go to sleep when we come, because I don't want to waste this message. When you rest and not tired, then we can. So technically, if you are there, crucified with Christ, it's no more you that lives. Who is the one that is that witness? Holy Ghost Christ, thank you, sir. He is the witness. But when we go for evangelism, if you see how we want our ways, if you see how we want to improve people, you know,
this is off record. Just like Jimmy, the guy who went to preach with, you see how he decorated?
See how he, what he wore, bulletproof and all this. It's not. Doesn't make sense. But what do we do? What are we supposed to do? Pastor, what are you talking about? But what are we supposed to do during evangelism? Declare the word of God. That's it. Declare the word of God. But that declaration is not... The truth is that none that will come across us this year, that will only be saved. They shall get born again in the name of Jesus. Now, when I was going through the word touch, in that scripture, the word touch, I got three things that really touched me. The background Greek and Hebrew meaning of the word touch in that verse, in this context, are to extend or to reach. Or this was the one that shook me. A man lying down with a woman. For the sake of the babies around us. You know, a man and a woman doesn't just lie down. And start, your nose is big, your eyes is wide, your nose is wide. That's not what they do. But do you know what this place was saying? You see, even to that extent, if a man and a woman lie down, if one is born again, it cannot make the other one born again. He said, you know, the word, what baffled me, what made me of absolute certitude is because God said it's a law. And most laws, you cannot see the effect until you fall into it. You cannot see both the good effect and the bad effect until you fall into it. You see, it's a law. It can, don't argue it. It's a law. It's a law that evangelism, you, the people you reach out to, the people you want to extend what you know about God. Say, ask the priest. It's a law. That you that is clean, born again, no matter how you minister to another, you cannot make that person born again. I told you the first thing. The first thing I say, you should put in your mind when you are moving for evangelism that you can never prove to somebody that God is real. Why? Because it's a journey of self-discovery. It's a journey of self. God did not say. You see, by without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can never discover God without faith. It's not something evangelism can guide you. Evangelism can keep on putting you on the track. But until you make decision to walk by faith, who can we use as an example? Apostle Paul. Do you know what Apostle Paul said? Let's go there. 16. 2 Corinthians 5:16. Yes.
Wherefore, henceforth, we know no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more.
Now, listen. Let me just close the Bible. See if I can bring understanding to what we have just read. Paul said, from now, henceforth, please, I beg you, know no man according to the flesh. He said, because when Jesus was on earth, we knew him according to the flesh. And we never knew he was the Savior of the world. Am I making sense? You see, from now henceforth, do you know, Jimmy, if I had known you according to the flesh, you wouldn't have been where you are now. The same thing with Van. When you guys came around me, I didn't know you guys according to the flesh. But that's not what I'm talking about. But I'm trying to tell you that Apostle Paul had Jesus evangelized to him so many times. That's what he said. He said, I had his message, but he did not change me. Do you wonder at times the same people Jesus evangelized to were the same people that crucified him? Because evangelism cannot make you born again. The same people he raised from the dead. The same people he preached to. The same people he healed. All these are evangelism. It was only few that got born again. Why? The Lord says many are called, but few are chosen. Just like the 10 virgins. The 10 virgins we are called, but only 5 we are chosen. The 10 virgins. Are you getting me now? Now, what does that mean? Apostle Paul lived on earth. It will be crossing that man. I will keep you one day. Sometimes he will sit down like the other Pharisees and bless him because he was a Pharisee. A Sadducee. Was he a Pharisee? He was either Sadducee or Pharisee. And they had it. The Pharisees. But Apostle Paul only got born again when there was an encounter. Personal encounter with Jesus. Paul, Saul, why are that persecuting me? Upon all the messages he had, upon all the evangelism by the number one greatest evangelist in the whole world, Jesus, he didn't get born again. Many Pharisees didn't get born again. So many people that you think that are born again now, that you have ministered to, I know you're born again. And you're crossing your fingers. And you're sitting down. What does that mean? If the trumpets sound, if they are not careful, we will not see them here. Because no one knows the way to heaven. No one has ever been to heaven. And no one will ever be to heaven, be in heaven, except Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. A man that understood that